welcome to the podcast.
Thanks for having me, Chris. It's my pleasure to be here.
Well, we briefly touched on who you were in the intro, but can you tell us a little bit about yourself, your background, what you do, and how lean or continuous improvement is a part of your life?
So, oddly enough, Chris, I started my professional career as a high school teacher. Out of college, I taught high school for 5 years, and in some ways, I consider that service to my country because of the low pay and the hand-to-hand combat and the frequent gunfire, just as a joke. It was a great introduction for me to learn how people learn, and that was what helped me become more successful at lean implementation later. After teaching, I went back to the University of Kentucky, where I worked in the Office of Continuous Quality Improvement for the Medical Center. And in this position, we taught the Deming philosophy, and it was great background to learn about Deming and process improvement and PDCA and the way he approached leadership and management. And some of the things we did there allowed me to become qualified in a sense to work at Toyota. And just by chance, my daughter's best friend in preschool, her dad worked at Toyota, and we developed a relationship. And he said, we're working on some things that are pretty close to what you're doing. Why don't you apply to work with us? And so I did it. And several months later, got through the process and was hired to become a coach at Toyota, helping managers who maybe were very successful at getting results on the floor, but needed help in how to maintain those results by building good relationships and good teamwork with people. And so that that background helped me get into Toyota. And when I got into Toyota, working at the largest manufacturing company they have outside of Japan in Kentucky, I had a great opportunity. And I consider myself one of the luckiest people to ever work at Toyota because I got a chance to work in three locations at the Kentucky plant and at the North American headquarters, and also had the opportunity to work at Toyota Motor Manufacturing in Texas as a startup, and actually moved and live currently in San Antonio. Within my Toyota experience, I got a chance to do a few really cool projects as well. One was called the Toyota Way 2001. That's what we called it internally. When they developed the Toyota Way internal program, they asked the regions of the globe to spread that. And I had the opportunity to do that at the plant in Kentucky. In addition to that, I was also a student of OMDD, which is Toyota's internal lean or Toyota production system teachers, the operations management development division, where I got a chance to learn lean from the internal senseis at shop floor in Kentucky plant and also in suppliers. And it was a wonderful learning experience. And also had a chance to work on what we call the Toyota Business Practice Project, which was a global project in conjunction with the group in Toyota Group in Japan, where we developed what is now known as the 8-step problem-solving process. And that was a global project that really helped help me understand more about Toyota, but also how I could contribute to other organizations as well.
Well, that's great. And I appreciate you being with us today. What do you do today?
I'm a partner with a consulting group called Honsha. Honsha is an association of former Toyota folks, and we work with clients all over the world. And I also do a lot of conferences and speaking, keynote speeches. And next week, for example, I'm going to Lithuania, believe it or not, to do a presentation and a keynote at a conference there for the Baltic states. So lean is definitely spreading all over the world, and even in places that maybe 10 years ago weren't even considered a viable country after coming out of the Cold War. But they're doing a great job.
No, that's great. Daryl, I'm excited that you're with us today. I know that the podcast audience is really going to benefit from your experiences and your knowledge in lean and continuous improvement. And I appreciate you giving your time to the podcast audience today.
Yeah, my pleasure.
Well, before we get started in the interview, we always ask our guests to share with us a quote or a mantra from their favorite lean leader. Can you tell us what your quote is and why you chose it?
Well, that's a difficult question because there's so many things. And one of the things that stands out to me, and I use this in my teaching and coaching, is a quote from Eiji Toyota, who is a former president of Global Toyota. And he said, "A person's life is an accumulation of time. Just an hour is important in their life. That employees provide their precious hours of life to the company, so we have to use it effectively. Otherwise, we are wasting their life." And I use that as a way to teach what respect really means is that as a leader, we have to view this as not just a business proposition when we're working with our employees, or just a business condition we're trying to improve when we're looking at lean, but we're really trying to make a work condition where people can contribute at a higher level, and that they can actually contribute to adding value that the to the product or to the service, and not just coming to work and not really knowing what their contribution is. So there's so many that I could choose, but I think A.G. Toyota's quote is one that I fall back on a lot.
Well, that's a great quote, and I'm sure that that resonates with a lot of the listeners of the podcast as well. Well, one of my goals for the podcast is to help other lean leaders resonate with your experiences. So can you share with us the story about how or why you chose your profession?
I think from the lean perspective, looking at that side of the profession, after I started learning more and more about the Toyota Way and Toyota Production System, not just from a tools perspective or even the what some people would consider the house of lean or the house of Toyota, but more the lean principles. And in the Toyota Way, we learned about the main principles of continuous improvement and respect for people. And when I started to see the connection between those key principles and how that really made the production system work, that was my real hook. That lean for me, or the Toyota production system for me, is not just something that we can think about as a way to make our businesses better, but a way to make people better. And so having that background and then saying, looking at how I can go out and then contribute to other companies and follow up on my passion for learning and teaching, then consulting became a natural way to do that. Having the opportunity then to connect with Honsha and then eventually become a partner with them has allowed me to go all over the world and spread these key principles of continuous improvement and respect. And honestly, sometimes I would just get bored going into the same door. And now I get a chance to go into different doors all over the world. And every time I walk into one, I get to learn more about new people and new processes and new businesses. It's just an amazing thing. But I will also add this, because a lot of people, especially a lot of my Toyota colleagues, will ask me about this life and consulting and going out and sharing these principles and the tools. And I always say that I don't recommend it to anyone, but I wouldn't change it for me. And I say that so that people are realistic about this kind of career, this kind of step, because I know so many people who are so much more talented than I ever was and am, who weren't able to make it. And there's lots of reasons why. Maybe the network just wasn't dense enough. There wasn't enough connections outside of Toyota or outside of their current business. But it's again, a lot of, and I don't like to use the word luck, but a lot of luck does come into it sometimes. So having the right connections and people that you've met along the way that help you be successful, I think so.
It's all about people and what you invest into them, absolutely. I know that you've had an incredible career with being able to go to a lot of different companies and share your experiences with Toyota. And I'm sure you've had a lot of successful moments or moments that you look back upon, you're like, that are touchstone moments for your lean career. But I also imagine that along the way, you've had some setbacks and some painful moments. And what I'd ask is, can you share with us the story of what you consider your biggest career setback or your most painful moment with your lean and continuous improvement journey, and share any pitfalls or mistakes that you went through that you want to share with the listeners?
Well, Chris, in true Toyota fashion, we focus on the abnormal first, right? So this is a good example of that. And there's so many I could choose from. It's never as smooth as we plan. But one thing that really stands out to me, we were working with a mortgage company. And this was right after the downfall of the economy. And this particular mortgage organization was working with a modification of loans and trying to help people preserve their homes. And but the problem was that they weren't able to process these modifications faster than the documents within the mortgage package would go stale. So, for example, if there was a wage statement that needed to be in the document package, in 60 days, they needed a new one. So if it took 61 days to start processing this, then it became like a death spiral in a sense. So we were asked to come in and help with this and did a lot of things early on to try to relieve some of the pressure on the timeline. But we quickly started a project in a model area where we were redesigning the work to go from more individual work that they were doing, looking at their queue of loan packets within their computer system. And we developed more of a cell-shaped operation in a sense, where they would work as a team on a package of loans and be able to maximize the time that people would spend actually doing their job, which in this case was making a decision. And we were doing really great work, working with a small group of 12 people, and making this model line within this larger group. But where we failed was not communicating well to the other 90 to 100 people that were on the same larger team. And we started to notice that people were kind of making up their own stories in the sense about what we were doing and how we were doing it. And of course, we were showing, you know, the progress we were making and starting to be able to add 30% and 50%, and then eventually doubling the productivity per team member of this team. And I think if we would have done it over again, is really thinking about the change management process, not just with the small team, but with that larger team. And that's a lesson I've taken into other projects, thinking about how do we communicate to the larger group what we're trying to accomplish so that they don't see themselves as being left out, that they don't start to see this as a competition between the way they're doing it and the way we're doing it, in a sense, maybe trying to disprove the theories that we're trying to prove within the experiments. So that's communication and change management is something from that project that I've tried to take and learn from in the future, even though, you know, still plenty of failure in that realm as well.
That's interesting, because oftentimes as leaders, most of the time we think of communication being directional as up or down within levels of organization. You know, we report up and then we communicate downward. But the challenge here was, how do you communicate across the organization and to your internal customers within the larger group, right?
Yeah, and I think what I was assuming, and we all know about the assumptions, is that communication was happening from the leadership across the organization, but that wasn't happening. And that's something that, again, learning, if it's not in place, then our job as coaches and developers of the leadership team, and also in this case, development of this team, it's our job to help coach them to do that and to make sure that happens. So it's vitally important.
So listeners of the podcast, you need to have a communication plan for how you talk about what you're doing and your progress and also your setbacks and what you're learning.
Absolutely.
Well, can you share with us your success story or your aha moment with your lean or continuous improvement journey?
Well, again, I think there are a few that I could draw from here. I want to tell you about one that I think was had a lot of learning in it, but it was also an incredible amount of fun. I was working with a leadership team of a small company once that actually they made the bags of soap that are in the dispensers in most restrooms, and something that we don't always think about, you know, being made, but there they were in this company. They made those bags of soap along with other things as well. And I was coming in on a monthly cadence doing a check on their Hoshin process and how they were actually deploying Hoshin throughout the organization and some of their Kaizen activities. This particular trip, they had, you know, as tends to happen, a crisis, and the leadership team had to be deployed in some other activity. And they said, since you're here, can you help us with this problem we've been having? They had a problem with what they called leakers, where these bags of soap were getting pinprick holes in the bags. And then when they would be back boxed and put into cases, and then the cases put on the pallets, when they got to the distribution center, they would start to leak. And then depending on where that bag was within in the pallet, it could contaminate, you know, anywhere from 60 to, you know, 25% of the pallet would be ruined. And so it was a big problem for them. And so I thought, how can I approach this as a way to teach, but also obviously I'm going to learn a lot. And I remembered doing the Toyota business practice or the 8-step problem solving process in my background. So we took a small team. I decided not to tell them what methodology we were going to use. We were just going to go through in general, understanding the situation because we couldn't get good data from the quality control people. So we went to the distribution center. I said, let's just spend some time. And in this case, it was almost 2 days going through every pallet that we see that has contamination. And let's take every one of those apart and let's find every bag within every box that has a leaker. And let's start to gather our own data. Again, no mentioning that we're doing step one or anything about 8-step problem solving. We just gathered data. And the whole time the team is coming up with solutions. You know, I'm having to say, okay, thank you so much. Let's just hold off on that. Let's just understand the problem. And we gathered data and gathered data. And we finally, using very simple methods. And we found out, that 40% of their problems were coming from one particular area. And, to make a short story a little bit longer, we took that from step one into the step two to break the problem down and set a good target, did our root cause analysis, which led us directly to one machine that had one part that had not been changed, that wore down, had not been changed in several months. And when we found that particular part and changed it, the problem, 40% of the problem went away immediately. Of course, the longer story would be putting in good preventive maintenance measures and those kind of things to make sure that we don't have that reoccur. But the beauty of that was the look on the faces of the team when they realized what they had done in a relatively short amount of time to help solve a problem for them, or at least 40% of a problem that had been reoccurring for years. And in this case, well over a decade. Now, we didn't take care of 100% of it. But that team was then ready to take on the next part and the next part. And I consider that a success because, honestly, I was a little nervous at the beginning that it was a last minute kind of request. And, could we be successful? But just trusting in the process and trusting in the people to eventually see the light as far as how the process could help them solve the problem. I'll never forget that. And I still take it with me today.
I think that's great because what stands out to me about that approach is when you had the problem, you didn't respond with a tool. You said, okay, I'll take a look at it. And you led them through the process and essentially applied the tool along the way.
Right. Never mentioning that we're using any tool. Let's just use common sense in a sense and then understand the problem, find the root cause, put in good countermeasures, and eventually they learn. So it was wonderful.
That's a great story. Thank you for sharing that with us. Do you have a lean or continuous improvement pet peeve or something that you frequently see being applied or being done wrong?
Well, I think the biggest thing that stands out for me is implementing tools in isolation without understanding purpose. And I'll give you an example of that. 5S, I guess, is one of the pet peeves, and we could have a whole podcast just on the history of 3S and 4S and 5S and why the changes, but for another day. I was working at the startup in Texas several years ago, and I remember walking past one of the Japanese coordinator's desk, which was visibly very messy. And I made a kind of a quick comment, said, oh, no good 5S. And he looked at me and said, you say that because you don't know the purpose of 5S. And in pretty typical teaching fashion, that's all I got. And I had to think about that and continue to think. And I, even to this day, I continue to think about what is the purpose of 5S? What was he really saying? And so when I go to companies now and I see people just saying, okay, we don't really know what else to do, so we're going to do 5S. And they're trying to implement 5S from they read a book or whatever. And it turns into a housekeeping exercise, which is not the intent. And I think about what my teacher said was, you don't know the purpose. So is the purpose housekeeping? His desk was messy. It wasn't perfectly kept. So what is the purpose? And after talking and learning and talking to my senseis over the years, it kind of came to the conclusion that the real purpose is to be able to visually, quickly, easily determine normal from abnormal. And nowhere in there does it mention housekeeping. Now, one of the results of it is it should look really nice and clean. But if we think of that as the purpose, then we just make things nice and clean. and we stack things very neatly and we make it look orderly, but without knowing that one of the best places for waste to hide is in a very neat, orderly, clean place, because no one looks for waste there. If we know the purpose, can I tell normal from abnormal? Then I'm able to think more deeply about that tool and not just implement it in isolation. And when I do that, I can also start to think about what makes this tool real. And in this same company that I went to, was telling me about before, they were implementing 5S, and there was no pull system pulling their product through the company. And so 5S kept slipping back, the lean leader would say. But it was obvious that without that pull system, making that 5S tool really meaningful, that it would never sustain itself. So that's one of my biggest pet peeves, I think, in general, is, you know, the isolated tool implementation without connecting to purpose and that without connecting to a system.
I love that. Being able to distinguish normal from abnormal, that's powerful. And it really ties back to the how and the why of you apply these concepts and these tools. Daryl, what do you consider the most important thing that you've learned in your career journey?
Again, lots of examples to draw on. I'm going to talk about one of the very first examples that happened after I left Toyota and I had my first experience in the consulting world. And it may sound like a nightmare scenario, but the first company I worked in had about 90 days to live. They had no cash. It was during right at the downturn and the crash of the economy. They were an automotive supplier, and all of their customers were canceling orders left and right, and they had, you know, 6-7 months of inventory stacked all around them. It was a great learning, in a sense, to go from a Toyota kind of nirvana for lean and TPS to go to this place that maybe had never heard of it and were swimming in waste, and they also had 3 months to live. So a lot of the rules we learned didn't really apply all that well. And so going into this very contentious atmosphere, working with the leadership team and trying to help them control, manage the situation, first of all, but then figuring out quickly how we could make some gains so we could keep the company afloat. And I had to learn what was happening on the floor pretty quickly, because I wasn't an expert in this field at all in what they were manufacturing. It was actually aluminum casting location, very loud and hot and dirty work in a sense. So I went to one of the oldest, most grizzled veterans in the company and asked him if he would teach me his process and take me to his job, and keeping safety in mind, you know, not to let me hurt myself, but can you teach me how you do your job? I was very curious about the work, but what the biggest outcome of that was being able to understand how they were doing the work, but also understand how they were feeling about what was happening in the company. So building that relationship, but also building it through getting your hands dirty and really learning the life that they are living on the floor. As we learned in Toyota, one of the quotes that kind of floated around within Toyota is that if you want to solve problems, you need to get your hands dirty. You know, don't be afraid to do that. And I would recommend to leaders, don't get too far away from the floor. And from time to time, go out and find that veteran that's working in the trenches, so to speak. And it doesn't have to be manufacturing, or doesn't have to be a dirty job. It could be in the mortgage company where the loan processor is working on 80, 90 loans at a time, and, you know, trying to juggle all their problems. Don't get too far away, and don't be afraid to go and see and learn and understand.
That's a great piece of advice for people that are, regardless of where they are in their career journey and as far as lean goes, to be connected to the work and the worker, one and all. Well, on the purpose of advice, there are a lot of different levels of experience when it comes to listeners of the podcast. Some people are just starting out with their career, and some people maybe are a little further along. What piece of advice would you give to someone just starting out with lean or continuous improvement?
The concept of humility comes to mind a lot. One of the models that we work with based on some of the work I did in Toyota is taking that continuous improvement and respect, two key principles, and looking at what's the heart of that and what drives it. And what drives it to me are the idea that courage is balanced with humility. And when we balance those two things out, we are able then to truly Kaizen and have a long-term sustainable culture of continuous improvement and respect. So the advice would be always err on the side of humility and beware the expert, and even beware of trying to become the expert or thinking of yourself as the expert, because there's so much to learn. And it's, I think John Wooden once was quoted as saying, it's what we learn after we know it all that really matters. And I see so many times where especially leaders get the idea that, you know, they've been there, they've done that, and they don't have to learn anymore. If we can start our career, start down this lean path, or even if we're in other fields, thinking that if I can just continually learn, then I'll always be one step ahead of the game. And when we stop learning, that's when it goes away, and or we go away in a sense. So keep focused on humility, I think, is a big part of that.
One of my earlier mentors in my career, he used to always tell me, when you think you're ripe, you begin to rot. And what he was saying is you need to be a constant learner, a lifelong student. And that has served me well in my career.
Absolutely.
What piece of advice would you give to the journeyman professional? In fact, maybe there's something that someone told you recently that helped you.
I'm going to go back to humility again. I know that was the advice we give to the person who's coming into their career. But it's the same advice that I would give to the journeyman professional. And maybe it's even more important because they do get the sense sometimes that, again, we've been there, we've done that. But I had this experience recently with a senior executive in an organization. And we were starting to work in one of their processes. Actually, it was looking at the bus schedules at an airport, transporting people from the main airport to the rental car facility. And it was a new process for them. And they were having trouble with keeping buses in queue and keeping buses ready and also getting people loaded and unloaded in a timely manner. And he said, made the statement that there's no way that we can possibly meet our time goal without having curbside assistance to help people in and out of the buses and make that process faster. But there was no data to back that up. So in a sense, they were saying they were sure. We were absolutely sure that this is true, which is a sign of more courage than humility. And so we said, let us gather data. And we went, we gathered data, we studied the process, and we found out that they weren't meeting the goal with curbside assistance in the current state. And we also found lots of other inhibitors to them hitting their goals. And so what we studied the process, took that current state back to this leader and said, well, in this case, you know, we're still not hitting our targets. Can you support us taking the next step and trying to go deeper to put in countermeasures to this? And in the end, we ended up implementing several countermeasures with the team, the internal team, that had them hit their goals of, in their case, a 5-minute turnaround loading and unloading of the buses, just simply by routing people better, by queue management, and helping people, having the buses have standardized work for loading and unloading without that curbside assistance. So I know that story may be a little bit minor for some people, but at the same time, it's indicative of a larger problem that many times veteran people have of, oh, I know already. There's no sense in gathering data and understanding when humility says, let's understand first.
That's great advice. Don't jump to conclusions. Seek first to understand, then to be understood. And oftentimes with big problems, little hinges swing big doors. You can usually make a small adjustment that can have a tremendous impact.
Yeah, absolutely.
Well, I know that you're the author of Toyota by Toyota, and actually, I believe Mark Graben may have recommended that book in his podcast episode as one of his favorite books for lean and continuous improvement. Do you have a favorite book, author, or mentor that you would recommend to our listeners?
Well, again, lots to choose from, and I'm going to choose for this Toyota Culture by Dr. Liker and Mike Kosais, and Mike Kosais is a friend of mine. From Toyota, but I didn't know Mike inside of Toyota. It's interesting. Mike in my career maybe overlapped by a couple of months, and he was actually moving out into some other career opportunities as I was coming in. But when I was teaching a lot of leadership classes inside of Toyota and working with leaders, it's not a stretch to say that half of the stories that I heard about good leadership were about Mike Hoseas. And I had an opportunity to meet him not long after that, a couple years after I started there, and then later on developed a good relationship, and we work a lot together now. But his book does a great job of helping demystify some of the cultural aspects of what makes for Toyota a great practitioner of lean. And it starts with bringing the right people into the organization. And it doesn't mean the smartest people always. It doesn't mean the most talented people always. It means people who fit into the mindset and will fit into the culture. And then we can teach them skills, and then we can do all the things that to make them successful. But that book really does a great job of helping companies big and small understand the nuts and bolts of what they can do, especially from a human resources perspective, what they can do to contribute to the organization.
Great recommendation. And we'll make sure that there's a link to that book in the show notes page for our listeners. I know, Daryl, that magic wands don't exist, but if they did and you had one and you could fix anything with an organization that you were coaching, what would you typically fix first?
You know, I think a temptation is to think about the kind of physical things that you'd fix and make sure all the machines are working well so that people can do their job. But that's, in a sense, a simple thing, as long as we're focused on doing it. But the thing that I see most of all in organizations that I would really like to make an adjustment on, and I guess what I work to make an adjustment on, but it just takes so much time, and that magic wand would be so good, is to really work on the mindset of the leadership team. One of the things that Mike Hoseas taught me was that as a leader, the people don't work for you, that you work for the people. And if we take that seriously and we think about how can I help people be successful when they work here? How can I help relieve system type burdens so that everything that they face every day is something that they have the tools to actually fix and to improve? And they shouldn't be burdened by system and higher level issues. I think having that magic wand to make that mindset adjustment so that people, the leadership team, could realize that I have to set a great system in place that allows people to be successful. And I have an analogy that I learned recently that may or may not be helpful. I don't know. You can tell me, or the listeners can tell me. I was doing a Gemba walk in Australia, and I went to a horse trailer manufacturing company. And they were telling me their philosophy of how they put together and design horse trailers. And they said they put this horse trailer together from the perspective of the horse. And they think about what can make this experience of loading, which is a traumatic experience for some animals, how can we make it as comfortable as possible? What kind of lighting, what kind of windows, what kind of on-ramp, what kind of mat that they're walking on, what helps them load in the most comfortable way and then ride in the most comfortable way possible? And so their whole design and philosophy was from the perspective of the horse, not necessarily the horse owner. Of course, we do that. The horse owner should be happier. And even though it's a small example, I think of that, if we could just have leaders think of the same way, how can I create a condition to where people can come to work and be successful and feel that like they can be successful from the very beginning and they've given everything that they need? So that's my magic wand that would make everybody's life a little bit easier. I know it's because it's magic, it's not going to happen. And that gives me a lot of work to do. So that's good.
That's a great story, because in that example, it points out that when people think about the horse trailer and the perspective of value, they would perceive that the customer in that situation would be the person purchasing the horse trailer to hook it to their truck. But in reality, the end customer that we're trying to demonstrate value to is the horse.
And the people who own those trailers, they love their horses. And they want to do everything to help their horse be, in a sense, successful. So we just need the leaders to take that same perspective of looking out for, in this case, the horse, or in the case of our people, is how do we set them up for success?
So, Daryl, I know you're going to be speaking at the TWI HR Summit coming up here in your hometown of San Antonio. Do you have any other things that you have coming up that you'd like to share with our listeners?
Yeah, one of the favorite things I get a chance to do is take a group of leaders and lean practitioners to Japan a couple of times a year. And that's the next one's coming up in May. And we have a chance to go to the origin of the Toyota production system, and which is the origin of lean, and understand from the source, in a sense, how simple a lot of the concepts are, and how sometimes when we get them back to the States, we complicate them too much. And giving it people a chance to understand the origin has been one of my favorite things the last 3 or 4 years. And so far, we've had great success taking folks over and helping them get that experience.
If people want to learn more about those trips, how can they find out more about that?
Our website is honcha.org, and we always have the next trip advertised on the front page. So it's real easy for folks to find out more.
And I'll make sure that there's a link to that on the show notes page as well. Daryl, thank you.